Okay, welcome everyone to the Introduction to Scientific Visualization with ParaView workshop. My name is Thomas Teusel. I'm here today with Glendon Holst. We are visualization scientists at the KAUST Visualization Core Lab. Before I start, make sure, if you want to follow hands-on session, somehow do stuff while we are doing it, make sure that you have ParaView installed. It's not necessary. If you just want to sit in and listen, that's perfectly okay, of course. You can get the ParaView, either use it on remote workstations, for example, from KAUST IT, it's installed there, or it's simply, it's open source, you can just download it and install it yourself. More importantly, the workshop materials, since you are here, you received the email, registration email. There was a link there for the workshop material. So please go there and download the data sets if you want to do the hands-on things. You can download the slides. They have all the information. And you can look at the other stuff we have at our wiki. So the main page is an overview of the Visualization Core Lab. And then we have this training page, which I'm going to talk about a little bit more later. Before I start the workshop, I want to quickly introduce ourselves and the lab. So the Visualization Core Lab is a part of the core labs, of the KAUST core labs, one of the 11 core labs. And the core labs are not a research institution, but a service facility. So we provide service and support for research that's done at KAUST. And we cover all kinds of different areas. You see these 11 core labs here. So depending on your research, you might want to check those other labs out as well. The Visualization Core Lab is together with the Supercomputing Core Lab. We make up the Research Computing Facility, which is, you see the head, Jisoo Lee, Facility Director on the left. Okay, to give you an idea, just to have an idea of what it is, the KVL team is here. You should meet the other guys, Soheb, Dina, and David in the other workshops that are coming up. Today here is myself and Glendon. We will be your hosts. Quick overview of what we do. So Visualization Lab does rests on three pillows. We have a certain facility support. We have specialized visualization hardware and software that we maintain and help to maintain IT, for example, the software. That's one part of our mission. And the second one is that we work on projects. We support data visualization and data science workflows, from the very small, like answering a question, to participating in whole projects. And the third thing is, that's why you're here today, is that we provide these trainings and workshops. We have expertise in visualization, 3D reconstruction, and large scale data science and visual analytics. So if you need help or ideas in these areas, just contact us. And as I said, we have we maintain a few major facilities like virtual reality environments, head mounted displays, tile display environments. We have a multi-purpose audio room, and we have a special high performance visualization hardware. Just a bit of an overview of what we do. What we have is we have two display walls. The large one you see here. You might know it if you go from the library in the direction of IT. It's right on the right hand side, and what you see here is a scientist looking actually at neurons of a rat brain. It's a very, very complex data set, so as much space as you can get for looking at that, that's rather beneficial. On the right, you see the people looking at the same data set or a similar one, also neurons in a brain, but this time in a virtual reality environment, a full immersive six-sided cave, which we have. And we have two more smaller scales virtual reality facilities, like the cube, what we call the cubes, and zone 5, which are semi-immersive, but easier to work with. And then we have this multi-purpose room, which has state-of-the-art video and sound hardware. So you can use that for showing videos, showing movies, 3D movies, or giving presentations in a nice environment. If you need some help or want to work with us, you can always book all of these facilities yourself. So if you know how to use them, if you've done it before, just go to this link and book it, and you can use it. In this situation right now, pandemic, of course, you will have to adhere to all health guidelines. We have them, so please ask us before you use them. If you've not used them before, there might be some organizational overhead before, like access cards and getting accounts, but that should be done in a few days, and you can request that. The most important information here, you have the slide in on the web page, is actually this email, help@vis.caust.usa. Just whatever you need, you have a question, you need support, just email us and we will get in touch with you. So here are the upcoming workshops that we do in this spring semester, essentially. You are in the first part of the scientific visualization workshop series, this introduction to scientific visualization with ParaView. In 3 weeks, March 25, we will have an advanced scientific visualization workflow with ParaView workshop, dealing essentially with parallelizing ParaView and programming in Python and things like that. And then we have two workshops on using Aviso and image segmentation 3D reconstruction. The first one will be next week, an introduction to scientific visualization with Aviso. This will be have quite some overlap with this one, but we will use Aviso and look at the special ways how to do things in Aviso as compared to ParaView. So there will be an overlap, but it's an excellent introduction to how to use Aviso for scientific visualization. And then we have an introduction to image segmentation and 3D reconstruction. So if you are, for example, using the imaging core lab to get samples of your data, and you want to segment them and reconstruct them and visualize them, then this is the workshop you should definitely attend. And we also have a series on data science workshops. I think these are interesting for anyone working in scientific research, not only data science. You learn a lot about tools that help you in your workflows, like Shell, Conda, Python, Git, SQL, maybe for database language. And if you're interested in machine learning and deep learning, then these are the workshops for you to go. They have already started, so the first three are done. I think Git is next week, yes. Okay, so what are we gonna do today? The first thing is this is a workshop, an introductory workshop that you should get an idea and hands-on learning how to use ParaView for visualization purposes. Normally, in non-pandemic times, we would do this in the computer lab in the library, and we would be there and help you, and we could show things and interact. That's of course not possible right now, so we have chosen to do this as a mixture of tutorial videos, live presentations, and Q&A sessions. I hope that works. If you have any questions, just type them anytime in the chat. The Zoom will save this chat, so we will not miss the question. Even if I miss it during, or we miss it during the session, we will definitely answer all questions afterwards. If you want to ask a question, especially in the Q&A sessions, you can also just unmute yourself and ask. And the second thing is, the main goal is to use ParaView for doing visualization, and ParaView is an open source software package. It's scalable, multi-platform. You can run it on Linux, Windows, and Mac. It is actually designed to support large data. We're not gonna do this today. We're actually doing quite some kind of smaller data sets just to get used to it. And it has actually a company behind it, commercial maintenance and support. And we actually have a support contract with Kitware. So if you have a very special problem, we can get you in touch with Kitware and use this support contract for your problems. So here you see a few pictures of what ParaView has been used to do. These are, for example, simulations like flows around a Formula One racing car or a tank. So rather normal scale phenomena, but you can also go to the very small, like this molecule down here, to the very large. This is a whole Earth simulation, an Earth mantle convection simulation. So ParaView can all that. It does not care what the data comes from. You can visualize essentially all kinds of scientific data. To demonstrate that or to show that, these are some of the projects we have worked with here at KAUST with all three different divisions. So in the Bezier divisions, you see the guys inside the brain again. The PSE, we have a combustion simulation. And in SAMSA, you have numerical simulations. So ParaView is able to work with all these kinds of data, no matter where you, in which field you are working. This is a quick overview of the ParaView architecture. It's not really very important, especially not for today, because all we're going to do is we're going to use this part here, the ParaView client. But just to show you, give you a quick idea that ParaView is actually much more. So you will learn a lot about the ParaView server in the advanced workshop if you attend. And what I want to say here is maybe the most important thing or most interesting one is that ParaView is built on VTK. VTK is the visualization toolkit. And this is actually older than ParaView. It was a programming library that you could use in your own programs, and you can still do. You can download and compile it and use it in your own C++ programs. And I'm just saying this here because some of the data formats you'll see later have these attentions, extensions, .vti, .vtr. They all come from the fact that the ParaView is actually built on VTK. So second part of the workshop goal. So why would you want to use ParaView here at KAUST? There are essentially two reasons for that. Is that ParaView is available here on all major computational resources. So it's installed on the supercomputing clusters, IBEX and Shaheen. It's installed on the remote workstations by ID Research Computing. And we have them installed on our large display wall clusters and the Conea, the Cave. So it's available essentially everywhere, and you can just download it. It's open source. You can just download it and store it yourself. And the second reason is that you have access to people who have expertise in using ParaView, not only in the visualization lab, but also in the supercomputing lab and at the research computing. There are people that use and ParaView and have a lot of expertise in that. And in later workshops, you will learn more about ParaView, more advanced topics like distributing ParaView on IBEX and Shaheen, programming visualization pipelines in Python, and doing in situ visualizations. That's essentially you doing the visualization already while you're running your simulation on a supercomputer. So you don't have to wait, let's say, a whole day until the simulation is done. You can look in while it's running if everything is okay. And yeah, that might be helpful. So this brings me to our details, today's agenda. After this introduction, which I scheduled for 15 minutes, and I'm almost done, so that's actually a good timing. I will start with the first part, doing an introduction to scientific visualization, techniques of scientific visualizations without actually going too much into detail of the theory, but just doing it but hands-on in ParaView to get you an idea of what you can do with ParaView and how to do this. The way I've done it, I have pre-recorded a few videos for that. So I'm going to do this conference style, and I'll show the videos. And afterwards, to each video, we'll have a Q&A session that you can ask questions. If you have questions, type them in the chat while the video is running. I'll try to answer all of them after each video. Afterwards, Glendon will give an introduction, a more comprehensive overview of the capabilities of ParaView, its GUI, its features, and how to do normal things like creating screenshots, animations, and what linked views are in ParaView rather useful. And these will be live presentations. They again can, of course, always ask questions, and we have actually some buffer at the end for discussions or questions. I just want to say here that the times you see on the left, they are not very strict. We are not. We don't have a real plan how long everything will take. We'll pretty sure we have enough time. 4 hours should be more than enough. But I don't know, if you're just interested in the ParaView GUI, I cannot guarantee that we will start at 3:15 sharp. So just to keep an eye on where we are during the workshop. Okay, we will definitely start stop at least at 5 p.m. So we won't do it any longer. I have to go. I have to feed the cat. Okay, here's an overview. Now very specific what we're going to do today. These are the data sets we're going to use. So we are looking in the first half, the part that I present. So we're looking at one example of a scalar field, which in this case is a CT scan of a head. And we're looking at some simple techniques like slicing, isosurfacing, contouring, sometimes called, and recasting. It's this picture here, the most complex one on the right. And the second part is about vector field visualization. And there we're going to use a simulation of the Red Sea, which has been provided by Professor Ibrahim Hotet's group, actually simulated on Shaheen. And there we will take a look at techniques like arrow plots, streamlines, and lick. And you'll hear this build part of this first part. You will hear details about these techniques. And yes, we will. So we are going to record the, this whole session is being recorded. You will have access to the videos afterwards. We are working out the details in what way we're going to do that, but you will get access to the videos. We're going to announce that through this email list that we have for you, where you got the registration link. Hope this works out, and let's move on with the first video. I'll run it. I'll just run the video, and then we'll have a Q&A. So before we do some scalar field visualization, I want to talk a little about how to load your data into ParaView. So let's go to ParaView. If your data is in the form of ParaView supports, that's easy, of course. You have this open data button here. Just press it. You go to the directory, you have your data. You select it. The way ParaView determines which reader to use for your data is by extension. So if you have the right extension, you can already press OK. If for whatever reason you have a different extension, you can select the reader you want here. You see there's a bunch of them, and you're going to hear a lot more about that later. However, in every once in a while, it happens that data is in a format that ParaView does not support. And there are two cases I want to talk about now. The first one is that you're given an image stack like this one, like, for example, it's the output from an electron microscope. This is just a bunch of PNG images. I can look at them in an image viewer, scroll through the files. These are meant to be stacked on top of each other to make up a volume. We have a workshop on image reconstruction and segmentation and on April 1st, where we use Aviso, which is a commercial tool which is specifically designed to deal with these kind of data. If you have, for whatever reasons, want to use ParaView to visualize this, you can do it as well. Here's what you have to do. The first thing is you have to number your files correctly. ParaView will order the files based on the last number in the file name. So here's the last number. It doesn't have to start at 0 or start at 1,000 here. There can be numbers before. They don't matter. There could be text afterwards. Doesn't matter. The last number in the file name gives you the sequence of the images. If you have that, let's go back to ParaView. You can just go to your directory, and you see now ParaView has already grouped these files into a group. You can open them here, and you see all your files are there. We don't even need that. We just select the whole thing and press OK. Then we go to properties, and here we see that ParaView recognized that we most likely want to read this as an image stack, which is true. That's good. And then we can define some data spacing. So for example, it often happens that in data from an electron microscope, the distance between pixels, for, let's say they are 0.1 millimeters, then the distance in z-direction is different from that. Let's say it's 0.2 in our case. So we can specify that here. And if you hit apply, ParaView reads the images now. We see a quick outline of that. I'm going to talk about this later. Let's take a look at what we read. So here you see that we have a 3D image. This is okay. We have a little bit of information about the memory used. Then important is the data arrays that are in your data. There's just one, the image values is the correct data type. And then we have the extents and the bounds. The extents are essentially just the resolution of your data. So we had 742 by 742 pixel images, and we had 466 of them. And the bounds are now the actual physically extent of your data. Since we said that in X range and Y range, we had 0.1 as our unit between the pixels. This is a tenth of this. And here we have a fifth of this because we said it was 0.2. So this looks correct. And we read our data. However, it's not the one we're going to use later. So let's go on. I'm going to reset my ParaView session here. We can do this with this button, reset session, say yes, ParaView will just go back to its initial state. And another case which often happens, the data you want to read is, for example, you have a simulation in MATLAB which just generates some data in a 3D array. Then you can write it to disk by just fwrite file name array. And if you choose binary, then you essentially have the data in a format which ParaView calls raw. MATLAB usually calls it bin, which is not good in our case because, so I have here an example of a raw file. I can quickly show you what happens if I just would wanted to use a bin file, like let's say from a MATLAB simulation. It will disappear because I'm only showing supported files. But if I go to all files, it's back. I could still load it, but ParaView doesn't know which readers to use, so it will present me with all of them, which is quite a list, and I will have to look through all of them. I know which one it is. It would be this one. But however, if the file has the right extension, let me so show all the files again. Let me change it back. If it has the right extension, ParaView just presents me with the readers that, that work for this extension, and I know image reader is the correct one, so I can use that one. You go to properties. Now we have to tell ParaView everything about this, this raw file, because it doesn't know anything. A raw file is essentially just a memory dump of a 3D array. So we have to tell it it's the scalar type that we have. In our case, it was unsigned care. We have the option between big or little endianness. So in our case, it's big endian. We can again specify the data spacing and the origin. In this case, I just leave them as they are. We have one, we're using a scalar field. So we have one scalar component, that's correct. Then our file dimension 3, we have a 3D array. And the data extent essentially just the array dimensions. And I know this in this case is 0 to 255, 0 to 255, and 0 to 255. So if we have everything correct, we can hit apply. And ParaView reads the file again, just a simple outline view, which we'll talk about later. Let's take a quick look if everything was correct. So we have again a 3D image. We have a little bit about the memory. We know there's just one scalar field in there with a data range from 0 to 255. And we have our extents and the bounds, which in this case are the same because I left everything at one. So that's good. We have everything we need. Now, if you wanted to do that again, you load your data again, you would have to specify all the time all these properties, which is a bit tedious. So what you can do now is make sure you have your scalar.raw selected. You can go to save data and save it in a format that ParaView knows. You have quite a few options here that work for this kind of data. In our case, the best one is actually a VTI. This is a ParaView native format, which is good. So we just save it as in this format. We get some options. We don't have to do anything here. Everything is fine. And we just use the default options and press OK. Now ParaView saves this file, and we are ready to do some scalar field visualization. All right, so this was the first video. Yes, so how do you know data spacing and data extent from your own data? This is actually a valid question. You have to know that because the point of a raw data is that you do it yourself, essentially. So if you are simulating something and you save the result in a 3D array, you know which area you are, which region you are simulating, and how the extents of the raw file are should be, the spacing in X, Y, and Z directions, and how many, what the dimensions of the area. So you should know that. If you just have a raw file which you don't know anything about, then you're out of luck. You for some reason can guess what it is, but you have to know. I just wanted to show this as an example, so we're not going to actually need it. Often you don't need it. A lot of simulation software, especially in fluid dynamics, for example, they already output data in VTK format because ParaView is actually a standard for visualization there. And a lot of other packages have conversion programs. But I just wanted to show that because it happens to me, it happened quite often that I have to do that. And it took me a while to figure it out exactly. And I just wanted to show the details. You're not going to need this today anymore anyway. All right. Any more questions? If not, then I will just draw the next video. So let's do some scalar field visualization. First, what are scalar fields? Well, you can think of it in 1D, for example, you have temperature at a certain location. You want to know it over time, and you know how to plot that. You can plot it as a graph. And ParaView is actually not the right tool for doing this. There are better tools like MATLAB, for example. In 2D, you can think of it of temperature again on a surface, or you put an object on a table and you want to know the pressure distribution over the surface of the table, or you want to see the height above sea level in a certain region, like in this example here. We're all used to these kind of maps. You could plot them as a 2D graph, as a 3D object, and sometimes that's done, but it's usually not as informative as these contour maps. For example, you know how to use them. You know if you're on the one side of the mountain, you want to get to the other side. You could even take the direct route and have a nice climb, or you have a leisurely walk around the mountain, but it will be longer. In 3D, you can think of scalar fields like the distribution of temperature in a room, pressure in a combustion chamber, or the example we're going to use, density of a head as measured by a CT scanner. So let's move to ParaView. So we have loaded the data and saved it in a format that ParaView can read. So let's do that. Go to the directory, you save the data, select scal.vti, hit OK, go to the properties panel and hit apply. The first thing you notice is that you don't see a lot. What you see is essentially a bounding box of the data. ParaView calls it an outline. The reason is that ParaView was designed to deal with large data, and an outline is just the safest default representation. So you could change the outline either here on the in the toolbar or in the display tab on the representation. Let's do that. Let's go to a slice. Let's look at a slice. So here now we see a slice through the data. It's still in 3D, so you can rotate the slice around. For looking at the slice, that's probably not what you really want. So you can align your view here with these buttons in certain directions. The Z direction is the one we want here. If you align it in a different direction, it looks like the data is gone, but it's not. It's just rotated out of view. So we can look at it in Z direction. And the next thing you notice is that the ParaView by default uses a color map, which is the default ParaView color map. And in this case, I don't really like it, so I'm going to change it. So here, it's this little icon here, which is called Choose Preset. If you press it, you get a selection of color maps, default color maps, which is a subset of color maps that are most often used. You can select all of them here, and you see there are actually quite a bunch of them. I'm going to use the grayscale color map here, because this is what the city and X-ray images usually look like. So you, for example, you see here the teeth. This is the skin of the head. And you can look at different slices now. So here in the display panel tab, you have the slider for the slice. You move it somewhere else. You see the teeth moving it up and down. And it's actually a nice exercise trying to visualize mentally now how the 3D object actually will look like, the teeth actually in 3D. That's what ParaView can do, we will do later. But let's take a quick look first. You can also change the slice direction here, only axis aligned, so you can go in a different direction. Now it's actually, again, rotated out of view. So you can try to find the right button here. So from the other direction through the YZ plane, that's what it looks like. I can again change the slices and try to explore a data set and try to figure out what is in there, what does it look like. Here you see the scale a little bit. But you might realize that it's actually pretty difficult to get a good idea what 3D information is in the data set by just looking at the slices. But anyway, let's stay at the slices a little while longer, but not just look at them. We want to do something, we don't want to compute certain things. And we cannot do that if we just change the representation. We actually have to extract the slice for that. So let's first select the scale again and go back to the outline, not this one. Here you see what happens when you press the wrong button. It might take a long while. In this case, the data set is small enough that not a lot have happened. Anyway, go back to the outline. So here you see the outline. Now we want to extract the slice. There are essentially four ways in ParaView to do that. So first we have to apply a filter, and there are four ways to create filters in ParaView. The first one is you have it in the menu. If you go to alphabetically ones, all of the filters. So here you have have not selected my skull. So none of them is applicable. If I select the skull, now you see which of these filters are actually applicable to the data I have at the moment. So there are a lot of filters, and you can scroll to this list and look for a slice. It's here. I'm not going to do that. This is useful if you don't really know which filter to use. Maybe you get an idea from the name. If you know which filter you want to use, there are faster ways. Actually, you have an alternative way here to just right click and say add filter. You have the same menu and now a list, but not actually in two columns, all of them, only the applicable ones now. Third way is that the often used filters are actually in the toolbar, and our slice filter is here. But if you want to use a filter that's not in the toolbar, but you know its name, actually the fastest way to do that is to press Option and Space on a MacBook or on Mac. On Linux and Windows, it's Control and Space, just to make it more interesting. You get this little window where you can type in the name of the filter, and if you know it, that's usually the fastest way just to get to the filter. In this case, I'm just going to use the toolbar button because it's there, slice. We get a slice filter here. We see it here, the red outline of the slice. We still see the outline of our data set. We have to go to the properties panel. And so we have to hit apply before anything happens. But before we do that, we can choose again the direction of the slice we wanna extract. We have three presets here. If you wanna use something different, an oblique plane, you can type in a certain normal here, but you have to do that manually. Anyway, the C normal, in this case again, is good for us. Let's hit apply. Let's hit the right view direction. And you see that this looks exactly the same as before, of course, because it's still a slice, but the difference now is that we have a separate object here in the pipeline browser, which is now actually the slice. So we have actually extracted the slice, not just changed the representation of our data. And another thing is you can actually change the slice interactively in the view. You just click it here, move it up and down. But I don't want to do that. I can actually reset this here. So in order not to change that accidentally, you can actually disable the plane here. But if you want to change something interactively, you can always turn it on again. I turn it off now so that I won't, if I rotate around here, not accidentally move the slice. Let's align it again. Zoom in a little bit, or actually zoom out a little bit again. Another difference you see is that now actually we are seeing still the outline of the data, which we did not before, because we are still displaying our skull here, which is in the outline representation. You can disable it with this little eye here, which just says show this object or don't show it. So if you disable it, it's not there. You can enable it. Slice on and off. So let's now go to the slice view. Actually, we don't need the outline at the moment. Let's zoom in a little. So what we can do is I want to create a contour now of this data. And the filter for in ParaView, it's called contour. Often it's called isolines, isosurfaces, or level sets. ParaView contour, and again, it's one of the filters that's often used. It's here. If you press it, you get essentially, the most important thing to see here is what's the value you want to contour by. And I don't like the default value here. Let's type in 56 and hit apply. And now you see that you don't see a lot. First of all, the first thing that happened is that the slice was actually disabled. That's the default behavior of ParaView. It disables, if you add a filter to another one, it disables the view of the first one. That's usually what you want, but not always. And for example, in this case, it's not what I want. Actually, I still want to see the slice. So I turn it off again. And I don't see any contour. The reason is that if you go back to contour and do a display tab, ParaView actually by default colors it by the same color map than it uses for a slice, which is in this case not really a good thing to do, because it has the same value as the slice underneath. So we just change it to solid color. And now you see the contour here. And the reason I chose this value is that it's essentially approximately the teeth. Again, you might want to try to visualize how this would now look like in 3D, which we're going to do in a moment, and see if you guessed it right. Just a few more things about this contours here. If you want to create a contour map like the one we've seen before, where you have several contours with different values, you could add all of them manually, which can be a bit tedious. So there's a shortcut here. Let me delete the old one, which is called this one. Add a range of values. Now you just have the range, which is by default the whole range of your data. And then how many values do you want? And what kind of interpolation do you want in between? And let's just use the default values here. You actually see the values that will be generated. If you generate them, they're actually here now, as if you had entered them manually. So that's just a shortcut. If you hit apply, you see now essentially a contour map of this slice. All right. But looking at this in 2D is actually, it's not really, it's difficult to see how the things would look like in 3D. So let's do a contour in 3D now, actually. And the good news here is, and that's one of the design principles of a visualization pipeline, is that we can use exactly the same filter, just apply it to the different data. So we use again the contour filter, but this time we actually apply it to the scaled data, the whole 3D data, and just use the same filter. And again, I use the same value of 56 and hit apply. And now I actually see my skull here. Again, the color is again the color of the color map, which I don't want. I want a solid color and white, which will be white by default. And that's what the skull looks like. So you might, first of all, you can now look at the slice. So this is the ISO value of 56, which goes exactly through the ISO line on the slice of 56, of course. And that's what it looks like in 3D. And yeah, if you thought that this would look like this, then you're really good at it. Okay, so the skull is here. You could change the solid color. You have a color map, you can change it to a color. If you wanted it red, it would be red. Not very. Don't like it. Let's go back to white. Okay. So that's how you can explore 3D data with contouring, either in 2D slices, 2D or 3D contours. Before we move on to the vector field visualization, I wanted to quickly demonstrate the what you can do with the pipeline and different filters. So for example, one of the things people often look at is a histogram. You just want to see what the distribution of the values in your data set are. And ParaView can do that. You have actually, it's one of the most a lot of used filters, which is in the toolbar. You can use this histogram icon here and just create a histogram. Make sure that you have selected the skull so that the histogram will be attached to the skull. If you do that, you get a little tab here where you can set the parameters. 10 pins is not enough, in my opinion. Let's use 128. And here you now see a histogram of your data through the whole data set. So you see that you have 56 was approximately the bones. You have not that much values of this high density. You have a lot of more values of lower density. This could be informal. But what I want to show is that we can actually now also create a histogram of the slice only. For that, we first have to split this window. We want to create it in a different window. And now select the slice, and again, just use the same filter of contour, apply it, not the contour filter, histogram, of course, apply the histogram filter to the slice, change to 128 to have the same as before, and you have the histogram of the slice. And you see it's different, of course, because the top histogram is for the whole data set, and the bottom histogram is only for the slice. And for example, if you change the slice now, let's do it manually, actually. Okay, one thing, I want to change something, and I was slightly confused because I couldn't see anything here. The reason is I have selected the bar chart view here. So a histogram is rendered in a bar chart view, but your actual data is rendered in a render view. So I just have to select my render view. Now I can actually access the things that are shown in the render view again. And what I want to do is I want to turn on the plane of the slice and change it slightly. Let's say up here. And if I hit apply, you see that the histogram of the plane of the slice changed, but the histogram of the data set, of course, stayed the same. All right, so this is a very important concept of the pipeline browser. Always make sure that you have attached your filters to the correct objects. So this contour and histogram are attached to slice one, and this contour and histogram are actually attached to the skull in order to see the right thing. Let's move on to volume visualization. All right. So before we go to the volumization, are there any questions to that? So these are the most basic. When you ever have a scalar field, as I said, scalar fields can be anything from pressure to temperature. In this case, it's density. These are, and this in 3D, these are the techniques that you usually use first. You slice your data, see what's there, then you try to extract a few isosurfaces, and that's the first things you're gonna do. If there are no questions, there are two things I was thinking. What's the time? We have enough time. Let me try to share my ParaView quickly. There was one thing I realized when I was watching that video again. So I have these properties view, display, and information tabs here. The default view, as far as I know, of ParaView is that these three tabs are actually grouped in one tab. And you only have two, you have only properties and information here. So if you want to change that, you go to the preferences. I think you might not see that they're selected, but they're just on the part of your preferences. You get these preferences, and on the general tab, you have to activate the advanced properties. You have the choice here on the properties panel mode. So I think the default view is combined properties panel, and I just like these separate panels for each type of properties. Much better, much more easier to use. Otherwise, you have this long panel where you look for things and never find them, in my opinion. But whatever you what you prefer, you can choose it here. If you then do say okay, I think you have to restart ParaView to see the effects. And the other thing what I wanted to quickly talk about is was this. I always said in the video that you have to hit the apply button, and I think I never explained that. So let me quickly load a data set again. So whenever you do something, so as I said already in the beginning, ParaView was designed to work with large files. And that's why it usually, when it changes something, which potentially could take a long while for doing with large files, you always have to hit apply, especially now for loading it, because you could, for example, choose which, if you have several data files in there, you could choose which data areas to load only. You always have to hit apply. And then it loads it. If you apply a filter, again, you can change things and change several things. Right? If only turning off this compute normals would take half an hour, you would have to wait now for half an hour. And then you want to change the ISO value, wait for another half an hour. That's tedious. So that's the design principle of ParaView. You always have to hit this apply button before something is taken into account. And if you have changed something, it actually shows up here in the bold font, and you can actually change things in different filters and data sets here, and then just hit apply once, and it will apply all the changes to all the data sets. So that's pretty useful. And actually, this is also a reason why I like to split these things, because I know that everything I do in properties, I will have to hit apply. Everything I do anywhere else will immediately change. I don't have to hit apply for those things. So in display and view, things are immediately applied. In properties, when you change something, you have to hit apply. That's what I wanted to say here. Okay, I don't see any questions. Let's just run the next video. Volume rendering. Okay, so here is an overview of the most common volume visualization techniques. We've already done two of them. We've done the 2D visualization or slices. We can slice through our data. We can look at the slices and try to figure out what's in the data. And we've realized that that's often rather difficult. So what we did next is we extracted a contour or isosurface, as it's called here. And that's often also called indirect volume visualization, because it does generate a triangle mesh, essentially, which is an additional object. There is a third method for volume visualization, which is called direct volume rendering, where you don't create any intermediate objects like a triangle mesh, but work on the data itself. So essentially just change the representation. So without going into detail, just to get an overview of what the algorithm looks like, it's usually called ray casting. And you think of your data lying around in space somewhere here, and you want to look at it. So you define, you want to look at it on your screen. So you want to, you define your image plane, and then you say you look from it from a certain point of view, and you want to know what do you see through each pixel of that image, in that image plane. So what you do is you shoot a ray from your eye through that pixel, and then step through your volume and keep accumulating the values that you encounter on that ray. And in order to do so, you need what is called a transfer function, which essentially maps your data values to color and opacity. And that's probably easiest to look at it just in ParaView. So let's go to ParaView. So here I'm in ParaView. I'm gonna load the state that I had from last time. So here it is. I'm not gonna need the histogram, so I just close the windows. But I wanna keep the contours, the contour, actually the skull, but I'm not gonna look at them at the moment, so I disable the view. I'm back at the skull. It's again in outline mode, so we don't see a lot. We want to actually look at it in volume rendering. So I have to select it. And on display, in the representation, I change now not to slice, but to volume. Then ParaView asks if you really want to do that, because if you have large data that might take a while, our data is small enough, it will be rather fast. So I usually click yes. You of course can click yes and don't ask again. If you click no, it won't work. Let's click yes. So here we are. We have our data set here. Let me try to look at it from the right side. There it is. So we almost see our skull again, but what's going on? Well, in order to see something more or better, more useful, we have to change the transfer function. We do this by clicking edit here, and this brings up the transfer function editor. So this is a transfer function. It's essentially a color map that here is still our grayscale color map. So it means map the low values to black, map high values to white, and the gray values in between. But in addition, we have an opacity function, which is this linear ramp here by default. Opacity just is the inverse of transparency. It just means how big is an object, how much do you want to see it? And the default here is that the low values are mapped to zero opacity, meaning completely transparent, or you don't see them at all. And high values will be mapped to fully opaque. You completely see them. And in between is, again, interpolated. So what's going on here is that we have assigned certain opacities here to these low values. So these low values in our data set are essentially the air around the skull, like here. And that's what we don't want to see. So we want to assign actually essentially zero opacity to the air. In order to do that, we just click somewhere here and generate a new control point and then drag it down somewhere here. And what we've done is now we are mapping all values between zero and almost 30 to zero opacity, completely transparent. So the air has gone from the display. And we see the rest in increasing opacity. And this is actually, that's usually the first thing I do when I get a volume to look at is I just load the transfer function like this. And that I create a point here and I drag it from left to right. Then I essentially see everything. I see here is the air. If I keep dragging to the right, the air goes away. And I see the skull. And if I keep dragging to the right, the skull goes away at some point. And we see the teeth. And if I keep dragging even further, the teeth will go away. And we are left with some structure, which is actually a tube that has been inserted into the patient, which is necessary for the CT scan to show up nicely. So we have four different things in this data set, which we want to take a look at. We're not interested in the air, but the other ones might be interesting. But just dragging this control point from left to right, that was actually pretty easy and fast to see that. You can, of course, compare that to the contouring that we had before. Let me split the window here. So let me create another render view. That's why I kept the contour. I want to see the contour here. Not the slice contour, but the skull contour. And this is what the skull looked like. There's a contour. It has the wrong color. I want just this, okay. And it looks almost the same, but not completely. But what we can do is we can try to, I have to select the skull, then my transfer function comes back. I can try to emulate that in the volume rendering because I know we had the isolator 56 here. So I can drag my control point here to slightly before 56, then create another one and make it completely opaque so that we essentially have everything below 56 will be transparent and everything above 56 completely opaque. So that's essentially the same as a contour, so as a surface. It does look slightly different. The reason is that by default, the volume rendering, it has a nice property which is by default turned off, which is called shading, which essentially just means that you're taking lighting conditions into account. If you turn it on, it looks a bit better. The color is different now. Actually, if we turn this back to contour image file, it should look similar because we are seeing the same values here. We see the value 56. And with the same colors, only a slight difference. So as I said, the advantage is with the volume rendering, you get a quick overview of what's in there. Let me remove the contour again, and let's work on this a bit more. So if I select the skull again, I get my transfer function. And let's try to get these three different, this tube here, the teeth and the skull separately with the transfer function. We can do that. Let's start with the tube. We just create a transfer function that we see essentially only the tube, like this. And I want to change the color. I cannot change the color. This is the control point for the transfer function at this value. If I double click it, we get a color pick. And let's make this blue. So now we have it in blue. Now, if I remember correctly, the teeth are somewhere around here. Let's create the three control points to bring out the teeth. There they are. They're also blue now because our transfer function, of course, now interpolates from blue to black. So we create another transfer function control point here, color point, by just clicking somewhere here. Actually, let's move it in the middle. And but again, double clicking, I can select the color pick. I choose white for the teeth. Now I have the teeth white. And then this the skin, the skull actually around the teeth is somewhere here. And I want to make them red. So I create another control point and make it red. But now you have, that's a bit too opaque for my taste. Make them that a bit more transparent. Actually, we can make the teeth more opaque. We see the teeth better. And now you see your skull, your teeth, and this tube with the high values. So the transfer function lets you, direct volume rendering lets you quickly look at your data, play around with the transfer function, to try to find all the structures that are in there. Okay, that's enough for scalar field visualization. Let's move on to vector field visualization.
Before we move to vectorization, are there any questions to that? I thought I wanted to say something. I'm not quite sure what it was. So yeah, I just wanted to repeat. So volume rendering is really a nice technique if you want to get a quick overview of a scalar data that you got. If you think you could do the same with isosurfacing and just try to go through all the ISO values and see what kind of structures you find with volume rendering, you essentially get it in one view. So that's the nice property of volume rendering. The disadvantage is a bit unintuitive probably when you do it the first time. I don't know how clear it is to everyone now what a transfer function is, but as I said, you will have access to this video. You can watch it as often as you want afterwards and try to replicate the example and play around with the transfer function to get an idea of what it is doing. I think there are no questions, so I will just go to vector field visualization and run the first video of the vector visualization.
So before we do some actual vector field visualization, I want to talk a little bit about the data and how to load. The data set we're going to use is publicly available under this URL. If you go to data, you can download it here. You have some description first about what it is, and then you can download here under accessing the data set. So the data is a simulation by Professor Ibrahim Hotet's group here at KAUST using our supercomputer Shaheen, and it's a simulation of the Red Sea. The data format is NetCDF, which is a common data format for these kind of simulations, but it has the property that it stores the vector components as scalar fields individually and does not actually specify that this is supposed to be a vector. This is what you have to know, and ParaView does not, so we will have to tell it. In order to use it, I have actually extracted the first time step of the first ensemble. This is a whole ensemble simulation over over 2 month period. So if you download the whole data set and extract it, it will be 1.5 terabytes. That's a lot, much too much for what we want to do. So I've only extracted the first time step, first ensemble. That's what we're going to work with. So let's go to ParaView and take a look how it looks like. So we go to open data. Go to our data sets, and here I have these three files, one file for the U component, one file for the V component, and one file for the W component. You have to load all three of them. We can do that at once. Just select them all and press OK. They show up here, and we can look through them before we hit apply. Go to properties just to make sure that everything is correct. Here you have V, W. OK, hit apply. And now we have loaded the data. We see our usual outline view. If we go to information, we see here we have a W component. In V, we have the V component, and in U, the U component. So the first problem is that we don't even have access to all of these components at once. We have to first tell ParaView that we want to have them in one object. This is done by we select all of them in the pipeline browser and use a filter called append attributes. Go to properties, there's nothing to do there. We just hit apply. And now if we go to information, we see that we have all three of them in accessible here. But ParaView still doesn't know that this is supposed to be a vector. They're just three separate scalar fields for now. So we have to tell it that it's a vector. And this we can do by using a filter, which is rather flexible, actually, and often used. So it's here, it's called the calculator. So we hit apply, we hit this calculator button, go to the properties. So the first thing is we got to do some calculations, and we will output an array. So we can give this a good name to this array. The default name is result, so it's best to change the default name. And I use UVW for lack of a better name. And now we have to type an expression here to tell ParaView that we want to actually append all these three scalar components into one vector. So you see all the scalars, you have them here accessible. You have U, we select U. And what we want to do now is we want to multiply this scalar value of U with the unit vector in X direction. And such a unit vector is often called I with a hat on top to make sure that everyone knows it's a vector. Just calling it I would probably be confusing here. So what ParaView chose to do is we can say multiply, calls it I hat. Okay, so then we multiply V. Now I just type it with J hat and add all of those together. And we get actually K hat, and we get actually a vector which now has U in its first component, V in its second component, W in its third component. We hit apply. And if you look at information now, we now actually have, in addition to our individual scalar fields, an array here called UVW, which actually is has three components. So you see the ranges of each of the three components. The first one is the same as U, second one is the same as V, and the third one is just W. So that's good. Now we have loaded it. Now we can actually do some vector field visualization. But as the scalar fields, since you don't want to probably do this all the time when you load the data, it's best to save it now as you have, when you have it in a format that we can read right away. So make sure you have calculator one selected here. Go to file, save data, and we are gonna call it UVW. And actually the right format to use here is again VTR, SDR3, and we select okay. Again, there are some things we could do. There's nothing we have to change. Default values are okay, so we just press okay. Now part of your saves, it's done. So we are ready to do some vector visualization.
All right, so the same as with the scalar field. The first thing I wanted to show is the most common pitfalls when you have to load vector data. And this most likely will come up, if you work with this kind of data, will come up sooner or later that you actually have to assemble three scalar fields into one vector field. And that's here is you see how you do it. You will have access to that video. If you do these kind of things, that should be rather useful. I have to do it all the time. I think I can just go on and actually let's look at some errors now, right?
All right, let's start doing some vector field visualization. Here is an overview of the techniques we're going to look at. In this first section, I'm going to look at error plots. That's the most basic technique. It's quite straightforward, easy to interpret. You essentially just put an arrow at certain points. The difficulty there is to choose at what points to put the arrows. And the perception usually is rather also difficult to see exactly what's going on. But the best thing to do is to just take a look at editing ParaView. So first, what we're going to do is we've saved the data in a format ParaView can read. So we're going to load it again. Here I have it, UVW. Let's just hit apply. Here's our data in the usual outline mode. And here it also works. Okay. For reference, I have exported the bathymetry of the Red Sea in a file so that it's easier to see where we are. I have it here and load this one too. And here's the Red Sea. I don't like the color map. Let's turn it off again. As usual, here's the Red Sea. You should know it, Gulf of Aden, the Red Sea. KAUST is approximately here. That's what we're gonna, that's what we can use to make the visualization a bit more engaging. So let's turn it off for now and see if we can do some simple GIF rendering here. It's actually easy. GIF is also an often used filter. So it's here in the toolbar. It's this one. Make sure you have the vector field selected. Hit the GIF, go to the properties. So here you can choose your glyph source. We want an arrow, that's fine. You have all kinds of different things, but arrow is good for us. The orientation array, we only have the one anyway, and we need one, so we take UVW. Let's leave the scale for now as it is. And the masking is actually quite important. The default mode that ParaView uses is, it just randomly distributes a certain number of points all over the place inside the bounds. That's usually a good mode because if you, for example, would choose all points, these are just far too many. I would recommend not to choose it here. It actually, on my MacBook, ParaView crashed when I did that. You could choose every nth point to get a more regular sampling, but a uniform spatial distribution just to get an idea of what's in the data set is usually a good idea. Let's leave the default values for now and hit apply. So after a few seconds, we should see our arrows, and this looks weird. But the reason, there's actually a simple reason for that. The reason is the following. It looks like all of the arrows are pointing in the same direction. So maybe we did something wrong when we saved the data, but we didn't. If you turn on the bathymetry, for example, you see that in here, there's actually something going on in the Red Sea. The problem seems to be just on the outside. And the reason is that there actually all vectors are zero. And when you go to the glyph again, the scaling here said scale array, no scale array, which is in ParaView, it means, and that's a bit weird, at least to me, it means it will normalize the vectors. And when you normalize a vector, you have a zero vector, you have a problem, and you have to do something by default. And so you could either just not display anything, but that's not what ParaView wants to do, because then you might think there is nothing there. So it just puts an arrow in the X direction there. Not the perfect solution, but at least you know something is there. And these are actually all zero here. And we don't want them normalized anyway. We want to see them at the first, at their actual length. So we just scale the array by its own length. So that's a bit weird in ParaView to see the arrows at their actual length. You have to scale them by their length, scale by their magnitude. If you hit apply, we see that the zero vectors are gone, but most of the others too. What's going on now? It seems that that's one problem with GIF visualization errors is also that we have some rather strong current here, which means a large arrow, and the currents in the Red Sea are actually much smaller, so they are almost invisible. And the next problem is that this uniform distribution throughout the bounds assumes that there is something going on within the whole region. In our case, that's not the case. So actually, these are not enough sample points. Let's just make them a bit more and see what that looks like. Aha, there we can see the Red Sea. We see some strong eddies here. We see something going on in the Red Sea. But if we turn it, look at it from the side, that also looks weird that in the Gulf of Aden, there's stuff going on way beneath the surface, but in the Red Sea, there seems to be nothing. But actually there is, if you turn on the bathymetry, and of course we don't see anything, but we can make it transparent here. So it seems that that's at least correct. The arrows are within the Gulf of Aden. If you look from top, they go down here, stay within the bathymetry. That's what it looks like. It's if you look at it from the side, it looks weird. There seems to be nothing going on. But if you look closely in the Red Sea, there are arrows there. They are just so small because the velocity is down in the Red Sea are actually a lot smaller. That makes sense, of course, but that they are so much stronger on the first surface, that was actually a bit surprising to me when I first saw it. But that's what it is. So what we can do is, first of all, we can try to make it a bit more informative by coloring the glyphs. Actually not with a solid color, but with a color map of the length. This is now redundantly mapping the length and the velocity to the arrows. You see the velocity in the length of the arrows and in the color. So the long arrows are actually red, the shorter arrows are blue. Redundant encoding of certain properties is usually not a bad thing. It makes you see things more clearly. So it seems that you can play around with that and you will see that it's actually a bit difficult to really get an idea of what's going on. Also, the problem is if you, let's look at it from the top and let's zoom into this Gulf of Aden region. Because the arrows are in 3D, if they overlap, you know that those are beneath the larger ones here, but if they don't, you're not quite sure where exactly is this arrow. Is it above or below this stronger one here? That's not really visible. You could, of course, then rotate around and try to get an idea, but this is really difficult and so it's not really a good a way to look at 3D flow. Actually, it's a good way to get the first impression, but to really get some understanding, it's probably not the best way. But because of the nature of this data, and we're actually interested in the surface anyway, we can actually do the same thing that we did with the scalar data. We can slice it on the surface and just look at the surface. Let's just do that. Make sure you have your vector field selected and just use the same slice filter as usual. Go to the properties. Again, we need the C-normal. And we want it right at the surface. Where is our surface? If you go to the vector field and look at its bounds, it is at the C range, is from -7.9 to -0.005. So the surface is at -0.005. So let's go there, back to the properties, put the plane at -0.005. Now it's on the top, on the surface, and hit apply. Okay, there is our plane. We could, for example, display the velocity magnitude of the vector field on the plane now. If that's helpful, I'll turn the plane off, so I'm not gonna change it and don't wanna change it anymore. All right, okay, we don't see the arrows. Let's turn the slice off. And let's turn actually the glyphs off and add some glyphs now only to the slice. Again, the same principle of the visualization pipeline. You use the same filters, just apply them to different objects. You get, I don't want the contour, I want the glyph. You can use them just on whatever you want. So here we now generate arrows only on the surface, on the slice. We use again arrows, we use the same orientation array. And now we leave the number of points again at 5,000. Let's just scale them already by the correct length, hit apply. Now you see that the arrows are actually only on the slice on the top, and you already see more of them. And that's what they look like. You can turn on the symmetry to get a better impression of where they are, make it maybe even a bit more transparent. Much, maybe like that. Okay, and you see, you see the current in the Red Sea. So you have some interesting, some strong currents here and here. It's mostly going to the north, but you have some eddy structure here, obviously. So you see some, but it's rather difficult. Also, it's difficult to get an impression of what's going on in 3D. So we're gonna take a look at streamlines and see if we can get more useful information out of that.
All right, so that was the first video on vector field uses, or actually the second, the first one for visualization of the vector field with simple arrow glyphs. And arrow plots is what they're usually called, and actually ParaView calls them glyphs because it does not only have arrows, you can use different kinds of glyphs. But you use the glyph filter if you want to do an arrow plot. So, yeah, that's what I wanted to say about that video. If there are no more questions, I can actually just go on and run the video for streamlines. One second. And share the screen. There we go. Okay, shoot.
So we looked at arrow plots. Let's look at streamlines next. A streamline is a line that at each point is tangent to the vector field. So intuitively, it means a line that follows the vector field. Mathematically, you have to solve a differential equation that's usually done numerically, and that's what ParaView can do. And let's take a look. So here's ParaView again, still have the previous session. So I'm going to reuse, but I'm not going to look at the glyphs right now. Let's turn them off. So we want to use these streamlines to get a better impression of what's going on in 3D. And you might have noticed that before that the bathymetry here actually looks rather weird. The Red Sea really is not that deep, and this is correct. The reason is that I've scaled the bathymetry by a factor of 10. And why I did that, I can quickly demonstrate. If I scale it back, I use a filter called transform. And just scale by 0.1 now, and you see that the Red Sea actually is not that deep. And if you try to visualize things and look at what's going on in depth here, it's just not very easy. So one common thing to do is to scale things differently than they actually are. You just have to know then that's what you did and how to look at the pictures that you generate. So we can delete this transform again, and we're going to work with this scaled bathymetry. All right, so the next step is now we actually want to generate some streamlines. The filter to do that in ParaView is first we select the vector field. It's called stream tracer, and it's a commonly used filter. So it's here on the toolbar, stream tracer. Let's just hit it. So here in the vectors, other vectors you want to use for integrating the streamlines. We only have UVW anyway, so that's what we're going to use. The integration parameters is we could do integrate forward only, backward only. We leave both for now. Here is the numerical integrator. You have the choice between three different Runge-Kutta methods. I'll also keep the default, the most accurate one. You could limit the length of the streamlines and leave them. This is actually the most important parameter is the seed type here. You have a choice between two different ones, the line. This is the one that you actually see here now, or a point cloud, which is actually a sphere. If I turn off the bathymetry, you see it here. This is essentially the points where ParaView will start the streamlines. And if you look at the line again, and look at let's see from top, that looks like a good idea to use just that. If you put the point here, one point of the line and the other one at the bottom, then that's probably a good choice for distributing seed line seed points for street lines anyway. But we want I want to have the streamlines all starting on the same depth at the surface at first. So I just changed the surface here, the C value of the line here manually. That's because I know it easiest. And now I see actually that I have put the line too far north because of the perspective. Let's put it back in where it's. Okay. The last parameter here is rather important. That's now the resolution is the number of points that we will generate along that line, that we will generate streamlines. And 1,000 is actually much too much. In this case, especially let's start with 10. You can always increase that, but that will be fast. So I hit apply and it's already done. And I don't see anything. So before, the reason we didn't see anything was didn't show up clearly. But here actually the reason is that it really didn't, nothing was generated. And a good way to figure it out is just to go to information and to look if you actually have something to look at. And here we don't have anything. So what happened? The reason is that the numerical integration here actually needs to start a little bit underneath beneath the surface. Otherwise, it just doesn't work. And we just put it here and here. We still have 10 points, hit apply. Now I see some streamlines. It looks good. So this line is good. I keep it, don't show it anymore. I'm not gonna change it. And here are the streamlines on the surface. So that looks good, looks fine. If you look at it, okay, let's turn for a second the bathymetry off. Looks also fine, but we have this weird thing that goes down here. That doesn't look right. It's rather unlikely that you really have a movement down there. The reason actually is that we're hitting the boundary of the Red Sea where we have the data and everything is zero there. And so something just random or weird happens there. We can avoid that in this case by turning on the advanced options and just make the terminal speed a bit larger actually. So we already stopped the streamline when there's still some velocity there, but that's for streamlines usually good enough anyway. This usually now removes the artifact here, and we have the streamlines on the surface of the Red Sea. Let's turn on the bathymetry again. Okay, so you can do all the usual things with coloring, displaying, but you have one interesting thing here. If you turn on here the advanced options, you can say render lines as tubes. That actually looks a bit, doesn't change anything when you do it because the line width is only one, but if you make the line width larger and zoom in a little, you see that I'm doing it in the wrong tab. That's why I'm not seeing anything. Doesn't change here anything anyway. I have to do it in the stream tracer, of course. Still have it here, advanced render lines as tubes. Okay, so now they look like tubes. If you turn it off, you see without the tubes, it looks just like a thick line. And with the tubes, you have a bit of a more 3D impression of what the line looks like. Okay. So we wanted to see
we wanted to do that in different depth, actually. And there's actually a good way. So we want to reproduce essentially the same set of streamlines, or at least the seed points for the streamlines. And there's a quick way to do that is if you go to stream tracer, the properties, you can actually here copy all these parameters, all these properties into the clipboard. And then if you go back to the vector field and generate another stream tracer, you can paste them in. And we have exactly the same parameters with the same line. And all we have to do now is change the depth. So I don't need advanced properties then. Just change the depth here. I want to create one at the so one at the surface, one at -1, and one at -2, let's say. Everything is exactly the same, so we don't have to change anything. We just hit apply. And then now we see, let's turn off the line. Now we see that we have more streamlines here on the bottom. We do the same render line as tubes to make them a bit prettier and more visible. Okay, that looks interesting and weird. We are integrating the vectors, actually, the 3D vectors, but it seems the streamlines are always staying in their planes, almost exactly in the planes. And that seems to be a property of this data, that the movement is mostly in the planes and not so much vertical. Let's just add another stream tracer, a third one at -2 quickly. That's quick, because I can again just paste properties and put them at -2. We have one here. We're still in the Red Sea, so that's good. Do exactly the same. And we have some streamlines. And we have the same property essentially there. Let's render the lines again as tubes, so they all look the same. Right. That's what it looks like. And so it seems that, yes, there's a lot of movement in within the planes, but rather little movement vertically. And actually, this what I don't want to do, so I just reset the line, and now I can say, don't show the line. Not going to change it again accidentally. This property actually of the data already shows up if you look here in the information of your flow field, is that the ranges of U and V are just a few orders of magnitude larger than in the vertical direction. So we could have seen it already there, but that's often, you tend to overlook that. If you just start exploring your data with certain visualization techniques, you clearly see it, and we cannot miss that actually most of the movement is horizontally here. All right, so again, the tricky thing here is to find good seed points to play around with the parameters. You can color things now with different vector magnitude, for example, to find different velocities of the flows, and try to find something interesting in your data. We're going to look at the last technique for flow visualization in the next section. All right, that's streamlines. So also a very common technique to visualize a flow. They work better in 3D usually, because you have a shading and see where the streamlines go. But we will see some problems with them actually the next video, which I think I can just start. So we've looked at arrow plots and streamlines for vector field visualization. The problem with these techniques is that you have to specify seed points for either the arrows or just the streamline, which is tedious and difficult to do. And you always have to risk to miss certain features in your flow. One technique that tries to overcome this, the last one we're going to look at, is called line integral convolution, usually abbreviated by LIC. And it generates essentially a dense visualization like this one, essentially on a texture. And how that works, let's just take a look at ParaView. So here I'm in ParaView with the state of the last session. I'm not going to use the streamlines for now, but I keep them. Let's just disable them. The first thing we have to do is we have to load this link as a plugin. It's only available as a plugin. We go to Tools, Manage Plugins. You get a list of all available plugins. We look for the one that's called Surface Link, select it, and press Load Selected. What I also usually do is I open this and then check the auto load,
checkbox, so it's going to be loaded next time I start ParaView. Now, what Lick does is it adds a representation essentially to the object where it's applicable, and the slice would be one. We already have a slice here. So if we look for representation here, it should be on the surface Lick, but it's not there. The reason is that that we have created the plane before we loaded the plugin. So we have to actually create a new plane, but it's easy to do because we go to properties, we copy the properties here and select the vector field, create a new plane, and paste the properties. So we have the same plane as before, but actually I want it a bit lower. And let's hit apply. So there it is. I don't need to show it anymore. I'm not going to change it anymore. And now looking at the Lick visualization for the flow, it's just as easy as going to display and changing the representation again. Now here we have surface Lick. We select it, and we have the surface Lick of the Red Sea. So you can look at it a bit more. For example, in the Gulf of Aden, you have this large eddy here and some large ones here, and the Red Sea. Very, very nice structures of the flow. But one problem you probably see immediately is it does not tell you which direction the flow goes. It's you don't see is the flow in this region, for example, going up or going down. If you add the streamline, the top streamlines should show up. We won't need the line. Which one is it? Moving in the wrong direction. Yes, there is a line somewhere in properties, of course. Let's not show the line. Okay, okay. So if you zoom in, now we have the Lick and the streamlines on top, but both of them actually have the problem that you don't really see, which even the stream, of course, the streamline doesn't show you either whether it's going up or down here. So let's just add the glyphs, slice glyphs. And then we have additionally to the dense visualization, we have a few streamlines and we have the arrows to give you an impression of where the flow goes. If you look at it, that's now what the whole visualization looks like. Can try to make it a bit fancier by rotating up and maybe showing the other streamlines that we have. They're not really showing. The problem with the Lick now is we could make the slice transparent, but the Lick unfortunately does not support transparency. So if you go to the slice, the one we have created, it's not applied, go to display, you had if you change the representation to the surface Lick, the opacity goes away. You cannot change it. It doesn't work with that algorithm. Anyway, so here you now see a little bit of the flow in the Red Sea. And a few streamlines underneath. Let's move the color bar over here. And yeah, that's an overview of the three very useful flow visualization techniques. Again, play around with everything, change the parameters, get a feel of what you can do, and try to visualize your flow. All right, so that was the last vector field technique. As I said, normally we would do this in the computer lab, and we could help you, and you could play around, and we could interact more. That's a bit difficult online here. But you have access to the data sets, and you have you will have access to the video, so you can always do it yourself later. I see there is a question. I think that seems to be a bit advanced. I'm gonna answer that offline. It's probably best. Don't worry. I'll answer that by email most likely. I think Ken, then we can go on with your session.
Fabulous. Hello, everyone. Thanks a lot, Tom. So that was actually awesome. So the I think what was really nice about that is that you got to see, we're introduced to scientific visualization concepts, but also to see how they're used and how the exploration process goes, the troubleshooting process. So so basically, Thomas has introduced you to scientific visualization and a bunch of techniques and approaches using ParaView. And so what I'm going to do is kind of the reverse of that, or the complement of that, is introduce you to ParaView so that you can also do scientific visualization. So why? Well, because ParaView is a complex, capable software package that scales from that scales all the way from your laptop up to the supercomputer, and which is one of the reasons that it is such a, you know, a good package, a good software to become familiar with, because no matter where you are in your exploration process or sort of data sets you have, when it comes to scientific visualization, it can grow with you. But that complexity means that there's also a steep learning curve. What I'm going to try to do is basically kind of introduce you to the logic of ParaView to kind of help you find your way around it so that you can accomplish what you want. So let me just go and share my screen here. There we go. Okay. So can you see my slides?
Yeah, it's perfect.
Perfect. Awesome. Okay. So I'm Glenman. So I'm a visualization scientist in the visualization core lab. Thomas is the scientific visualization expert. I help with the interface between the scientific visualization and the HPC cluster, and with machine learning engineering and support. So what I want to do is I want to help you use ParaView to do the scientific visualization. And one of the, probably the central thing to understand is what does that process entail? And I want you to keep this model in mind, this kind of pipeline of data flow. So data starts at a data source, your data set or whatever it may be. It then gets processed by a bunch of different filters. You have seen a bunch of them, everything from pending data sets to slicing, to glyphs, to licks, all sorts of different filters can get applied to the data, or ISO services and so on. And then, you know, these filters, you know, transform the data into different types and to different, they produce different, something different, but you know, for it to be useful, you have to be able to see it and interact with it. And so this, these filters kind of produce these bunch of different views that you might get, whether it's the histograms or the volume views, or slices or whatever. And even, for example, the, property sheets and the color map and color transfer dialogues and so on are a type of view that lets you kind of explore and interact with your data and kind of see what's there. The other thing though is that at the end of the process, you're kind of trying to produce something. Either it'll be a movie or a screenshot or a graph or something that will be used either to share with your colleagues or in papers or for your own understanding. There is some product that you want to get out. And if you keep this pipeline in mind, it's going to help as we kind of find the pieces in ParaView that help with different parts of this pipeline. And the other thing maybe to keep in mind is that these pieces kind of fit together kind of like Legos, but you know, Legos kind of all fit together. But in this case, we have kind of Legos of different shapes. So not everything fits together. Not every filter can be applied to every type of data. Some of the data might need conversion. Not every view is produced by every filter, right? So how you kind of connect them together is going to depend a bit on what sort of output you want and what sort of data you have and what sort of filters you'll be able to apply. So if you keep this little pipeline in mind, the rest will kind of start to fit into those slots. So what I'm going to do is basically introduce you to the overall GUI of ParaView and kind of where to find things, the kind of the logic for its organization and some of its features. And then we'll explore a little bit more about how you can create work with the views, some of the different things that you can do, and also some of the different outputs that you can create. And I'll show you how we make some of those outputs. So the first bit of overview is for the user interface. Now you'll see this slide is a bit old. This is an older version of ParaView, but the new version, very similar as well. But you know, the refinements that have happened over the years have definitely improved this substantially. You know, and the organization of ParaView has it's pretty good even here, but it's really pretty nicely refined, and it fits in kind of with the categories that I mentioned in the pipeline to begin with. The different parts of the screen to get familiar with is, you know, the menu bars and the toolbars. You've seen, of course, Thomas go to those. That's kind of standard for GUIs. standard for sorts of GUI programs. Everything that's in the toolbar, you know, is accessible someplace else in the menu, but the toolbar tends to put the things that are kind of needed most often directly in front of you. I should probably mention that, you know, when I said that ParaView scales from laptop to supercomputer, I probably should have mentioned that it definitely benefits from a larger screen. So when you see some of the demos that I'm going to give here shortly from my laptop, the screen we'll illustrate is going to be at a premium. And, you know, these different views and menu bars and toolbars kind of eat into that, into the visualization space. But they're useful because the things that you often need are going to be there. So probably the key, the most important part yes, the visualizations are important, but it all comes down to creating this visualization pipeline. And that all happens in the pipeline browser. That is where you'll see where your data gets loaded. That's where you see that the filters get applied. And you'll see kind of the connections between them. It's drawn as a tree between, you know, the data, which is kind of at the top level. And then as you go down, it goes down to the filters and down maybe to outputs, for example. There's also various views that you have. There's, of course, the main view, which here is the kind of the main interactive rendering view. That you will see the main products of the output, and also where you'll kind of interact with that, you know, adjusting camera angles and so on. The rest of the views that are kind of around the rest of the screen, those are basically kind of editors and that let you adjust and modify the attributes of those views to kind of create the color transfers, the animations, and just adjust the properties. And you've seen Thomas use all these different aspects, but that just gives you a sense of kind of the standard layout for ParaView. Okay, so the first thing we're going to talk about is sources. So to begin with, you have to have some data. That data can come from a host of different sources, you know, CT scans, simulation results, all sorts of different places for, you know, 3D data and so on. When it comes to files, there's a bunch of different ways to open these. You can either go from the file menu, or there's a file icon, you know, to open icon. In the pipeline view, you can even just right click and get an open there as well. And what's going to happen is that when you do go to open, you'll get the dialog, just kind of a standard file chooser. And you'll see also the list of the types of files that ParaView supports. It supports a large variety of data formats, file formats. And so that's the data sources, but there's also a different type of source as well. And that is kind of, kind of programmatic type sources. There's customizable, programmable sources, but there's also just, basic meshes and things like that. So why might these be useful? Well, the programmable, sometimes some of the filters, for example, such as glyphs and others, want a source to indicate like where are the seed points, and so you will need a source, but it won't be a data file source. So this is a way to kind of specify that. So those are kind of where you will find the menu options for loading data in, which is basically kind of the file menu plus a few other places, the toolbar and so on, and then sources. So those two menu, files and sources, are kind of the main ways of bringing data into ParaView. So I see there's a chat message. Let me just check. So I'm not familiar. Claire asks if there's a good cheat sheet for the UI components. I'm not familiar with one. If I did, I would link to it for sure. But there is help available. I'll mention that in a bit. So basically the screen that I showed before, that kind of showed you the basic layout, that's kind of like the quick getting started overview. Most of what you'll do in building up these pipelines, once we get the data loaded, is just applying filters. That's probably the biggest thing, and then customizing the attributes to adjust what sort of view you get. So those two things. And when it comes to the filters, there's kind of this built-in help for that, and there's also help for the views to some extent. There's also kitware for the ParaView website has, there's documentation, there's actually full books on how to use ParaView. And there's also a wiki where a variety of different topics are discussed. One of the issues with the kitware wiki is that because ParaView has been around for a while, some of the guidance is a bit dated for significantly older versions of ParaView, especially if you go looking around on the web for it. But probably those places would be the best place to start, and they're linked from the training page for this. Cool. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over to my ParaView. So can everyone see my ParaView screen?
Yes.
Yay! Awesome, fabulous. Thank you very much. Okay, so you should see the menu and the toolbar, and right now the pipeline browser is empty, and so there's a bunch of different places to open things. There's like the file open we saw. There's also this this open now has an arrow up because it's going from the file system into ParaView. We could also right click on built in, and you can just open stuff directly there. I'm going to just go to this a toolbar icon, and I'm going to go to the data sets, and I'm going to go and just get say, well, so just as before, and I'm gonna go to volume view. So, and there we go. So this is another head, a data set. So I really like the volume rendering view. I think it's such a great way to get kind of a fast way to kind of explore, get a sense of what's in the data. Tends to look very nice as well. There's so that's an example. I can also load another data set as well. Let me go here. I'm going to open So this is a so this is a can. It's a can being crushed in an Exodus 2 file format. So one of the interesting things to notice about this data set, however, is that there are a number of variables. And by default, not all the variables are going to be loaded. So why? Well, it's not uncommon for data sets to have lots of different variables in them, just because some of them were used by the simulation to help compute other values, and they just kind of remain around. Or, you know, sometimes the simulation software is kind of configured to create a bunch of different variables, but, you know, the scientist might only be interested in some of them. And by only loading the variables that you're interested in, you can save space. You don't have to load it all into memory, and that kind of speeds things up. So by default, it only loads some of the variables. And what I'm going to do is you can just click on like the variables there and either open all of them or none of them. So I'm going to go for, because these data sets are small, I'm going to open all these and make sure that all the variables are available to me. And I'm going to click apply. And I'm going to just hide the head because the can is actually much, much smaller. You can also use these toolbar items here for basically centering the focus on a particular item and making the center point kind of at the center of wherever that data set is, just to make it easier to work with. One of the interesting things, let me just try to, is this particular data set has a temporal component. And if we look up here, we see that we have 43 time steps. And if I press play, I can see that a cross section of that can get crushed. So that kind of a different component. So this data set had had different types of information in it, had a bunch of different variables. There's some other interesting things going on with it as well. So it's colored two different solid colors based on the VTK blocks. We'll explore that in a second. This is it's a complex data set with a bunch of variables. Let's go and explore some more things about it. So in this kind of properties view for the pipeline, so as Thomas mentioned, this is not the default. The default is to show everything. I know, you know, when I started using ParaView, you know, part of that learning wall was like, I know I've seen this option, but where is it? Right? It's just really hard to find. So by splitting things up, I kind of can start remembering, is this a property that, you know, I need to press apply for, or does this affect what the view looks like, or is this about display, or is this just about information? So that's why I ended up getting my this panel split into four different parts. Let me just show you how that's done. So if I go to preferences, it's under general. So by the way, it's not there by default. And I wanted to show you something else about these kind of information property views in ParaView. There's often a search, which does help narrow things down. But you kind of have to know what the word was to search for. And there's also usually a basic view and an advanced view. And it's usually the advanced view is available via a toggle that appears with a gear next to whatever the search is. So if I look down here, there's not that many items, but if I press the advanced properties, suddenly you see the scroll bar changed, and there's a lot more properties there as well. So now, where is that property that I am looking for? So let me go and just try to do a search for the properties panel. So maybe panel, and oh, look, there we go. So we've kind of narrowed it down. And the one that was of interest is the properties panel mode. And the default is to combine everything together. And So what I've done is choose separate panels for each type of property. And one of the issues though is that when you choose that, you'll have to basically quit out of ParaView and then run ParaView again for it to take effect. It doesn't take effect immediately. So that's how I get this kind of this properties view split into four different types of information. Let's go and take a look at some other information about this particular CAN data set. So first of all, I see right away that it's a multi-block data set. So I'm going to see if I can show the wireframe for this. So basically, you can see that it's done as two meshes, kind of an image array, and it's done in two parts. Let's see, element block. Yeah, so there's two basically element blocks, ID1, ID2. And basically there's two node sets that kind of come with them. So there's a little bit of information about it. There's also where the file came from, how many cells in the data set, how big the data set is. There's also a list of variables in this data file. And one thing that's kind of useful is the range of values there, which can be useful to see if the data set has been loaded correctly, and there's something in there, you know, there's not just all zeros. You can see that there's a range of data set, a range of data. So for velocity, you see that this is a vector, a three-dimensional vector, so interesting in the X and Y direction, there's no value. So all the velocity is in the negative Z direction. And acceleration, a similar thing, three dimensions, and we see the range of the acceleration values. So that gives you so similar to that histogram view, which gives you a sense of the data values in the data set. This is kind of like an even higher level overview of what your data set has, and each of the variables has. So, and you've seen that as well. The other thing here in this data set is that there's because there's a time view, there's an index to the time, and then there's the actual time. So usually myself, I don't really care about what the real time scale is. It's just like how many frames are there to view. But if you're doing a simulation and you know how long some sort of process takes is important, you'll be able to see it. And in fact, if I step through the time here, you'll see that now I'm at frame two, but the time is 0.0002 seconds sort of thing, right? Okay, so that's some information about the data. This is we've loaded data in that is the file based, and we've kind of loaded two different formats. One was a VGK image format, the other was an Exodus 2 multi-block format with time information or time frames in there. let's look at another type of data source. So we can go to sources, and we can go and you see that a lot of these sources are just basic shapes and meshes and box and cones and cylinders. And so let's go and go sphere. Okay, when we do that, we have a bunch of choices that we can make about how big it is and its center, its resolution, and the how many segments for each angle, around the circle, which is basically kind of, determining how many rectangles to use or how many polygons to use to make this. And that's the resolution of this. Let's apply the defaults here. And we get this default surface view. So this, it is a source. It didn't come from file, but it's just kind of generated. So it's a generated source, but it's a simple one. And if I look at it here is a wireframe, I can see basically what the resolution is going to be. So for example, for some of the convolution and glyph type of visualizations where you need starting seeds, you know, the vertices in this might be the starting points if you were to use this as a source. What I can do is I can bump up the resolution. And after I hit apply, you see a little more sphere-like, right? So voila, there's my sphere. So. And there's a bunch of other different shapes there. One of the interesting things is that, and it's very powerful, is that we can also have a programmatical interface using, so let's ignore that, those errors or warnings. So we can also have a programmable interface. I'm going to turn off the sphere. So ParaView stands for, it's a, you know, parallel visualization or parallel view built in VTK. It uses Python wrapping. So VTK is written in C++, but it uses ParaView quite extensively as a wrapper around VTK. So it is fully programmable. this becomes important when we create our own kind of batch pipelines. So basically, you know, today's tutorial is more about us interactively exploring a data set, but once the data set gets big enough and, you know, we have many, many time steps and we don't want to kind of wait for every frame, we might want to, you know, basically take our pipeline and process each of these frames on the supercomputer on Shaheen. And to do that, you kind of have to specify what it is. What's the visualization pipeline? What will the outputs be? What should I do? And that's going to be done with Python. So it's very powerful, very program, you know, entirely programmable, very scriptable. And the cool thing also with ParaView is that you don't really have to know a lot to do that, because you just, if you know how to use ParaView, you can just record all your actions and it gets turned into Python. So like I mentioned, we're not going to discuss that today. I'm not going to really, you know, we're not going to explore the programmable features, but the upcoming advanced training on ParaView will show you how to create these programmable pipelines. And we're also looking to have future lessons directly from Kitware that will explore more in more detail how to program these pipelines. So for our future lesson, we're going to kind of trust you've had a little bit of experience with Python and then use this, the script recording capability of ParaView to help create them. But there's a whole you know, powerful tool set available to you. And this source filter lets you programmatically generate some sort of data object. I'm going to show you how that's done, but I'm going to use a pre-made script. This is just a Python script. And I'm going to, this is the source script, and I'll just kind of maybe just quickly walk you through it. I'm going to import math. You know, there's a Python thing. I don't have to import VTK or ParaView because that's done by default. And what we see here is that basically I create a poly data type. So that can, for example, that was poly data, polygonal data. And I'm going to create, using VTK, I'm going to create kind of a points object. It's like an array for points. And I'm going to go through and I'm going to create these points in 3D, X, Y, and Z, and insert them into my points array. And then I'm going to you make some other points and so on, insert them. And then I'm basically this PDO, which is the polygonal data type object. I'm going to set its points to be the points that I just generated. And then there's also some additional stuff for creating links between points. So what happens if I go and run that? I go apply, boom. I get a little DNA strand, right? So we can kind of see, you know, what the cosines and the sines are doing, creating these shapes, offset, and then the other, you know, basically finding points on those lines and kind of drawing lines between them. So now I have a source, some sort of source. So the source can either be from a data file that has come either from a microscope or simulation, or you can create your own, or you can use some kind of built-in generated object as well. Okay, so that's sources. What comes next? Well, after data came filters. And now we are in, that's kind of the core part of the core power of ParaView is just the wide variety and sheer number of filters and processing tools that ParaView has. Fortunately, they are mostly under one menu, which is the filter menu. You've seen a little bit as, you know, Thomas was doing his demonstrations, all the filters are there, but they're also broken down in a variety of different ways. We can go to kind of by category. So if we know kind of what category or the filter or the processing that we want to do, if we know what kind of category it fits in, kind of go there. We can also be, there's also a section for recent filters. So once you start using a few and you know what you like, and it's easier to go back to them. You can also search for them by name. And there's also the alphabetical view. That's probably the most important. So I really like the alphabetical view because it's the way to find everything at once. And so on the Mac, as we'll see, its standard menu, you know, things that don't fit on the screen, you have to kind of scroll up and down. On Linux, you can see all the filters at once. So it's a really nice way to kind of see everything at a glance, just so you know what there is. I should point out that this isn't even all the filters. Some of them will come from plugins that you'll have to enable. And you saw that for the lick filter. The line integral convolution filter. One of the things you might notice is that some of the filters are grayed out, and those means that those are not presently available. And this has to do with kind of the expected data type that filters expect. So the filter is kind of like a mini pipeline in itself. It requires input, it produces output, but it requires that the input be of a certain type. So different algorithms have different requirements. Some may be more efficient if they're working with rectilinear image data set. Others might work just fine for meshes. And so if the analysis of the tool that you want is grayed out, is not available, you will probably have to find some other filter that does a conversion for you. Now, one of the nice things about ParaView 5.9 is that when you mouse over these unavailable options, at least on my Linux system, it'll give you a little hint as to why it's not available, like what it is that you'd have to do, which is nice. But usually it's some sort of conversion. It might be an append, I'm just looking for it. It might be like a resample, or it might be like, you know, points to cell or cell to points, those sorts of transformations. So there's also available, so the other way, of course, to look for the filters is with the search. And if you know kind of the name of something you're looking for, it's another way to kind of scroll through and find stuff. That gives you the list of what's available, but how do you know like what would be good to use or what's applicable or how it works? So for that, there is quite good help available online under the help menu, under the reader, filter, and writer preferences, you can get kind of the list of all filters, plus a little description and including some a guidance for how to use them. Also, when you've selected the filter and it's in the visualization pipeline, the vis pipeline, and it's currently the one active, and you're looking at the pipeline properties, then there's also usually a help button there. Let's go and explore filters a bit. So one of the things I'm going to do before I go there is I'm going to disconnect, which is kind of a way to kind of clear the state of ParaView and to kind of bring it back to the original state, at least as far as the data is concerned. So right now we have no data. I'm going to do an open. Okay, I'm going to load something called disk out. Let me get all the variables. Apply. Okay, so what is this? A can. Oh, it's hollow at top. Let's go and look at what filters are available for this. So if I go to alphabetical, I can see what's available and what isn't. So Glyph is available. I can also see, I can also see what's available here as well in the toolbar. Let's go and create a clip of that. Okay. So now I can see a cross section of this. Let's show. And so what I'll also do is now I want to create I want another filter. I want to be able to see the flow lines, for example. So in that case, what I will do is I will choose, let's see, I'll go to filters, I'll do a search, I can go glyph. So by the way, let me see if I can. So there's a 2D glyph, a glyph with custom source. Ah, that could be interesting. Let me go and I'm going to go to sources and I'm going to create a sphere. There we go. Okay, I'm going to apply that. Okay, and I'm going to make it, I'm going to adjust it so that it's bigger. Yeah, it's a little too big. Cool. There. It's kind of upside down compared to what I wanted. Okay. Ah, so I mean, we're getting a little ahead of ourselves here, but down the bottom, I can kind of see which direction is which. They're actually negative Z. Okay, so or positive Z. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna change this to be the 2.5 for the center of this ball. Okay. So I'm also gonna change the resolution for the sphere to be a little larger. So okay, so this is just a data source, but I'm going to hide it because it's not too interesting. Well, I'll hide it later on. So let me just try this. What does arrow do? So I can, in the properties panel, I can choose help for that. And this gives me information, for example, about this arrow. So appends a cylinder to, appends this arrow source, appends a cylinder to a cone to form a 3D arrow. Okay, so that's not what I was looking for. But that gives you a sense of, that all the properties panels for filters have help available. And there's also, let's go to the reader filter and writer reference, and I can go to the filter section. And now I can find the names of all the filters that are there. So I'll delete arrow. That's not what I wanted. So if I go to recent, so the recent one was the stream tracer. That's what I had done previously. Okay, but I want it to have a different source point. So seed type.
Yeah, so there's a stream tracer with custom source. That's what you were looking for, right?
Exactly, yes. Okay, so let me try it. So you see it. So stream.
It's not, you have to select.
Oh, yes. Where you perfect, are. Okay. So I see it grayed out there. Okay, so this is good. But because I have the stream tracer already selected, it's not available. So I'm going to just delete that one again. And I'm going to go here. And now I'm going to try to search for stream tracer. Oh, there we go. Stream tracer with custom source. That's the one I wanted. Okay, and now similar to before, we choose the input, the output, that disk. And then for the seed source, I'm going to have that sphere at the center. Okay, I believe there, that's much nicer. Okay, so what I can do now is I want to kind of make these lines a little thicker. And so what I'll do is I'm going to search for tubes. And there's one named tubes. And okay. And now what I can do on the, so I'm displaying the tubes, that individual stream trace lines are not shown, but they're still there because they are the kind of the input for the tubes. And now I'm gonna choose, so let me just choose velocity. What's the velocity there? Or should I choose, what would be interesting? Temperature. Oh, temperature could be interesting. And again, I can go to help for this, tubes. And I now have a fairly complex visualization pipeline built from the original data set. I've sliced some of it out, which is this clipped one here. Okay. So I'm not showing the full can. I want a cutaway, but I want the stream trace to be based off of the entire can, not the entire disk, not just this half of it. So there's some things that we can do to kind of improve the quality of the actual rendering of those lines. So one has to let go. Okay, there's the ambient. Okay, so there's the ambient color out of that. Cool. Okay. So basically, I've kind of been monkeying around with the, I brought in my data source, and I've been just kind of exploring the available filters, trying to find ones that kind of do what I wanted, and used a combination of searching by name, looking into the help to try and find out what it was the filters did. That help was available in two different places, and eventually I'm able to build the view that I like, the rendering that I like. So let's go back to our slides. So now we've kind of seen how we kind of go about finding the filters that work for us. So the next thing to look at is the views themselves. So there's a number of different ways that we can work with this. We can have multiple views, but we can either have them all together at the same time, or they can be tabbed. And especially when screen real estate is at a premium, having a tabbed view so that you can go between different visualizations is good, but sometimes you need to compare things side by side. So the key thing is in the top where the tabs are, we can add new tabs with the plus, and we can also close a tab, rendering tab out with the Excel close icon there. And we can also do things within this, within a rendering pane. We can split it into different sections, zoom it out to full screen or it's the full area or back to tiled. So the other thing with views is that, so that main rendering view, that's one of the views, but there's also, property panels and toolbars and so on. And those are available under the view menu. So it kind of makes sense. Like, for the data, there's files, for sources, there's source, for filters, there's filters, and for views, there's views. And these different views, these kind of property panels and so on, they will appear at different places around the kind of the main rendering view. So things like the color map editor tend to appear on the right hand side. That visual pipeline always on the left by default, and it's definitely good to have it always be visible, because it really is, it's kind of central. But these other views, they can be moved around. In fact, all the views can be moved around, customized. Views can be put in the same area of the screen, but kind of overlap each other, kind of like, tabbed views. Some views will go in the bottom part of the screen just because they tend to be very long, longer than they are tall. So the animation view is an example of that. Probably the most important slide that I can show you is this one right here. So the hardest thing for me when learning ParaView is, understanding what's going on. The reason being is that every view has a configuration for it. And so all of your filters have properties, right? Those are configurations for a particular view, but you only see one of these at a time. So the properties, these attributes of the filters and properties of the input source files, information about the color maps and what gets displayed, they all show up in these different views that are somewhere, on the main ParaView screen. So there's only going to be like one color map view ever, even though every different view can have its own color map. And when it comes to properties like for, like for whereabouts you clip, or how many glyphs or how many points are in your starting point source, those things are associated with kind of nodes in the visualization pipeline. But there's only one place they get displayed, right? And that's the pipeline properties. So what shows up there depends on what is currently selected, both the view and the source or the filter, right? There's basically many different copies of these kind of attribute property configurations, but the one that you see is just the one that matches up with whatever the current view is and the current source or filter node that you have selected in your pipeline. The others are there, but they're just not being shown until you select the right combination of things. And so we'll see a little bit how that plays out soon. Okay, and this part I already explained how to get the nice view in the pipeline properties view with the multiple tabs. Let me just go and just quickly explore the views here. I can add another view here. When I do, it will let me choose what sort of view that there is. What I will do is I will choose a histogram view. And this doesn't really seem very interesting. Maybe what I'll do is I'll just, I'm going to add a filter this way, and I'm going to add a histogram view. So under data analysis, histogram. Okay. Under this histogram, I'm going to maybe choose 100 bins. There we go. Okay. So if I go back to this view, which is the rendered view, you know, none of my changes here are going to, if I apply them, nothing seems to have happened because it happened on the other view. If I have multiple views, so let me just go and try to take, let me just load up another data source. I'm going to open up a rendering view for it first. Okay, so there's my head. At this point, I have two data sources. If I go back to this rendering view, I don't see the head, right? And and you can see that what's being shown here is this basically this clipped view of the disk and this tube view. And if I change to layout 3, now we see that the clip and the tube are hidden. That's what these little arrows are for. So if there's probably a big difference in size here. So we can kind of see how much smaller that can was compared to the head. If I hide the head, that there's the tube and there's the clip. Now notice that they don't look as nice and colorful as the one that's over here, right? And the reason being is that when I had made, so for this particular view, this particular rendering, I had already gone through and set a bunch of options. Like for example, for the clip, I said that I wanted to have it colored by, I wanted to be a surface colored by the velocity. And for the tube, I'm gonna have it be a surface based off of the temperature. But for this other view, that is not the case. It's just a solid color. And for this clip also, it's just a solid color. The attributes show up in the same place in the interface, but they're referring to different things because it's a kind of a combination of what is the current view that's selected and what's the current object or filter or source. Let me reveal the head again. And we see that the head is, at least is, its extent is significantly larger. I'm gonna turn off those other little data sets in the background. So let's go here. Here I have, okay, so this histogram. So what's displaying here is a histogram, but that histogram belongs to that disk. ParaView has frozen. So I'm going to have to unfreeze it. Which kind of brings us to, so ParaView probably didn't try to save. Okay, so we're back here again. I'm gonna go for an example visualization and I'm going to go for one of the built-in ones. There's a bunch of built-in visualizations that are available under help. This disk is an example of them. Their version is quite nice and you can see what they have chosen as default values. So if you're trying to figure out, how to recreate some, you know that you wanted to do streams and tubes and some glyphs for the arrows. You want to see how it's done. You can use some of the built-in examples, and then just look at the pipeline and see how it's done. So let's go and just let's see if we can create. I'm gonna load this other data set again. Let me open up here. I'm going to open up histogram view and let's see. There we go. Okay, cool. So here's a case where, the data set we are able to kind of directly view a a histogram without actually having to kind of create the histogram filter. But we don't have the same level of control, the number of bins and things like that. But you know, for a fast view, it's a start. And so what I'm going to do here is I'm going to split it up into two, kind of do it horizontally, and I'm going to choose another histogram view. Okay, so, but in this case here, you know, we can't really choose, this simple histogram view isn't good enough, but what I can do is I can create the histogram off of this, add filter, I will go to data analysis. Histogram, I will choose as the input array, our temperature. Apply. Okay, so in this case here, it added another view to our current tab, and I can get rid of this other one here that I don't want. So by the way, if I toggle back and forth, you can kind of see, I'm just going to close this one off, and now I have a way to compare kind of these data sets side by side. And what you can see is that if I click on this top one, I see that the square head is the data source that's selected, that's visible because the eye is there, the eye is open, and on this lower one is the histogram that's visible that the eye is open. Okay, let me go back to this layout view, which is really quite nice, and let's see what else we've got to discuss. So this basically gives you a sense of you know, when it comes to configurations and settings and so on and properties, that even though there's only one view for them, there's actually multiple different kind of hidden versions of those. And the one that's visible and editable is the kind of the current version, the one that's dependent on what's currently selected. Okay. So let's go to explore the properties dialog a little bit. So we'll look at what display offers us and what view offers us, and the pipeline info, which we have kind of looked into a little bit. So let me go here back to ParaView. Let's go for display. So let me go here. So let me choose something that actually is being displayed, which is this, this clipped of the disk, and right now it's showing temperature and the surface. So what display, typically the things that end up in the display section have to do with kind of how things get rendered or put on the screen. So part of the biggest one is the color transform or the color editing. That appears on the right hand side. You've seen Thomas already use this to basically specify, you know, transparency and to create a color transform. You can also create multiple bins, color bins, so that you can kind of see, especially if you have like labeled data, you can, each label can be a separate color. We can also choose a different a color map. So let's do this rainbow one. Probably not a great one for this, but this still works. Okay, so okay, I'm gonna turn that off. Okay, so we've got kind of a different color set. I can also enable opacity for this. So even though this isn't like a rendered, this isn't a volume view, I can still, for example, highlight certain regions of interest. So for example, let's say I wanted to get rid of the yellow region, I could kind of carve that out. Adjust your color map to suit. if you want to kind of look at two extremes in the data, typically you'd go to your histogram to be informed by that. But there is an example of using one of the kind of property panels, this view. I'll show you another one shortly. Add another view here, and I've got a render view. Let me go and load this canned data set. Okay, so this is one where you see it runs over time. There's a time component there. As I rotate this around, you can see that on the screen there's other in this view there's other information. So it's not these kind of annotations to the data being viewed are not part of the data object itself, or the so they're just part of the view. One of them is gives you the coordinate system that helped you kind of read or interpret the data. We can go and turn that off if we want a really nice, clear display. We can get rid of that by going to view, property views. We can also choose the background color. So we can also drag this legend around if we want. And display, we can choose whether, okay. Yes, so here is whether or not this table gets displayed. It's in the display part. Color maps are attributes of how the entire object gets displayed. So things like coordinates, the coordinate display, whereabouts the center is on the object, grids, if you want to, for example, have a sense of the size of things or how they're situated. You can add these axis grids as well. There's you can set the background to be some sort of interesting color. So there's like a gradient if you wanted. So that kind of gives you a sense of the various views. Let me show you one more here. And that is, so I go to view and I go to the animation view. So it shows up at the bottom section, and it lets us, we can kind of drag through the timeline. And as you see, when we play it, we see kind of how it goes through the timeline. And we can do certain things like adjust the camera position over time. So, but we'll come back to that in a little bit. Okay, so the next thing we'll want to know how to do is how do we delete things? So let's say I wanted to delete this disk in its entire pipeline. The problem is that delete isn't available. The reason being is because if you can imagine this Python like a tree, we have to kind of delete from the leaves back up to the root. And we can't delete from kind of the root level or higher levels. All the children have to be gone, or we just select all of it. So if I select all of it here, delete now becomes available. And, but I think here, if I went to properties, so here in properties, I can see delete works for histogram because histogram is a leaf. Glyph is also a leaf, but tube is not. But if I select both tube and glyph, delete now becomes available. I can delete them all. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to go and I'll delete that. Boom, they're gone. And I'm going to delete all of these. And now I just have basically the can and the I have the can and the head. And so on layout one, that's where we had the disk before, but because it's gone, nothing appears here, but I can make the head appear. Cool. So that's kind of how we delete things out of the pipeline. We can also disconnect the entire pipeline. So you've seen me do that before, where basically that's kind of wiping all the data sources, all the filters, and we just kind of go back to an empty pipeline. You know, so we can't delete roots before, we can't delete a parent before we delete all the children. But what we can do is select all the tree and then do a delete. And we can disconnect all at once, which I'll show you how to do. Okay. And so I'm just going to go here and disconnect. And now, so I want to jump ahead to a section. Google. So let's just talk about, let's say you have a visualization pipeline. How do you preserve it? That's kind of the essential thing. So the way to do that is to save state. So ParaView has state files that basically, this records the pipeline and everything about it. So I'm gonna call it, let's call it, and now if I go and kind of delete everything, so, you know, I clear the session. Yeah, so that, and now the session's blank. What I can do is I can kind of bring it back to that previous state with load state. And I'll show, let me just load this one here. This is the one I just saved. So when you go to load the state file, it just doesn't come back immediately because it has references to these source files. So the source files are still there in the same place. And so you may think, well, why would it be asking us, where are these files? And the reason being is that we often create these state files on different systems for where we might use them. So on Shaheen, your data might be under /projects or /Lester projects, but on the remote workstations, it'd be /Shaheen/projects, right? And so you'll end up with different paths and different systems. And, you know, and so you might, maybe on your workstation or your laptop, you might have a small slice of your data, you know, somewhere on your desktop. And so you create the visualization pipeline, but when you go and basically load that pipeline state into, let's say, your workstation or some other computer where you have the full data set, it might be in a different location. And so you want to give ParaView a chance to try and find where that new location is. So we have three choices. We can use the file names and the full paths as they're specified in the load state. We can do a search for the file names, or we can kind of choose to replace those file names. I'll show you, you know, choose file names. And we basically see here that we have a reader that looking for a particular file, but there's also a file prefix that's also part of this. It ends up being the same thing. So I could go and basically kind of reload both of those. So I have the same data file, but in a different location, right? So this is under my applications inside the ParaView application. I'm going to go and use the one that's part of my data sets. So this is a disk out. And I'll do OK. And so it complains a little bit, but boom, there it is. But using a different data set than the one I had before, but the rest of the pipeline and the filters and the visualizations and setup, it's all there. Okay, so that's, you know, if you're worried about losing data, use save state. That's the key. That's basically, you know, the kind of the document format for visualizations is a ParaView state file. Okay, we've already kind of been using multiple views a little bit already, you know, we've seen them, we've opened them up, we've had them side by side, but we haven't really kind of used them to their full potential. So what I'm going to do here is basically explore what we can do. So to basically keep them synchronized with each other. So one of the things that we can do is we can, you know, split the view, the rendering view, in two, have two rendering views, and then link them so that they have the same camera. So then whatever we do with one, as far as like where we view it from, that will, you know, automatically change the view in the other, which is useful because it's useful because if you want to see what the bottom is like, you know, let's say for temperature, then you can also see the bottom of what this can is like for velocity or whatever other variable you're interested in. The other thing we can do is we can have comparative views. Basically, what comparative views let you do is similar to this, you know, linked camera view, but they let you compare against different time steps in the data. For example, it's kind of a more powerful view. So you can kind of see different stages along the sequence of the evolution of some system all at the same time. So let's go and see how that works. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to just reset that. I'm going to load the cans. Variables. Okay, so and there's my can, and if I go and run it, there we go. We see the can getting crushed. So what I can do is, let's say I'm interested in velocity. So let's see what that shows us. Okay, so we see that the velocity is, maybe we're interested at kind of the interface layer where it actually gets crumpled. Let me split this view. I'm going to have another rendering view, you know, same. So again, you know, in one view, the can shows up, right? In the other view, it doesn't. And because they have separate configurations. But if I click visible there, and again, so at the same time step, but if I go and I look at different angles of this, it doesn't change the in the other view. And so let me go instead of a solid color, I'm going to go, how about displacement? Displacement's interesting. I'm going to go back to the beginning and so what I'd like to do is basically synchronize their views. So I'm going to basically right click on one of them and just choose link camera. And then I just have to click on the other view. And now the cameras are linked. So it links to the camera on the right. So I'm going to recenter this. And I also want to set it so that the can is up. So as you see, as I move one around and explore it, I'm also, the same changes are happening in the other view. If I run it, I can explore it together. And so the basically they are synchronized together as well. But you can see that because they have different colors, they are displaying different attributes. One is displaying velocity, one is displaying displacement. Okay, let me try to explore in a comparative view. So I've created a new view. I chose a rendering comparative view. By default, it comes up with four. If I go to view, I should see the comparative view inspector. Okay, and here's where I can choose my overall comparison. Sorry, my overall number of how big the layout is in each direction. And I can also specify what is different between these views. So I'm going to choose time. And by default, for each of these views, it's like a little spreadsheet. It's basically chosen kind of, you know, four equidistant times. And if I go and, let me see here, if I make the can visible in the display, so what I see is that, so the cameras are synchronized, but they're not synchronized live the way that they are for the linked camera view. And the other thing is that each of these views will be like for the same data. So I'm gonna choose velocity again, because it's kind of the most interesting. And now I can basically see, how this data set evolved over time, right? It kind of all at once, and I don't have to run through the time view to do that. Okay, so that's comparative views. So I've already mentioned about exporting state, and we've seen how to reload that. So let me actually just go here, and I'll save this one out because it has two kind of nice layouts. So what let's do is I'm going to go file, save state. And I'm going to say can example. And again, I'm going to kind of delete that. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to load that last state that I saved, which was the can example. And I'm just going to use the defaults, just use files names from the state file, because things haven't moved. And voila, I'm right back to where I was before. Everything's the same. Cool. So far through our pipeline, we've got through, you know, the sources, both from data files and from generated. We've got explored a little bit how to find the filters and find help for them and how to attach them. And then we've looked a little bit as to how we can work with different views, modify properties, when those properties apply, kind of this mental model of this kind of hidden configuration that is only visible when we, for things and views that are selected. We've seen how to save our work and restore it. But the last thing in this process is basically how do we get these nice views that we've got out so that we can display them. So there's two outputs that I'm going to discuss today. One is just like the screenshots, which is kind of just a single image view of whatever the current visualization is. And the other is animations. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to just load the a state file that I had previously, this disk example, which was a quite nice. So what happens if I want to capture an image of this? So getting a screenshot is actually quite easy. We just go to file, save screenshot. So basically, the start of the pipeline and the end of the pipeline kind of come from the same place. That's the file menu. So we can save a screenshot. So if I go here to file and I go save screenshot, and I can go, and I have choices as to which image format I'm going to save it as. PNG is just great, so I'll save it as that. Now you can also choose some other different properties. For example, whether to make the background transparent, compression level, also image size resolution. Some data formats, especially for video, want to be at certain sizes, but we'll just leave the defaults as they are. Now, if I go and look, so if I look here under disk screenshot, voila, there I go. The interesting thing is that this is a kind of higher resolution than what we were seeing within ParaView, because the ParaView screen, the part of the view that we were looking at, was quite a bit smaller than this. But Cool. So that screenshot. Let's go look at the next one, which is animation. Saving animations is quite easy. It's just almost as easy as saving a screenshot, but you'll probably want something that has like a time view. So let's go and load up the can. So now we see that the, you know, there's 43 steps. And now if I run play, I'm basically going to see what the animation is going to look like. So let me go and just save a simple animation. I'm just going to save the animation here, and I'm going to call it, disk animation. So the cool thing is that I have a bunch of choices as to how this animation is created. I can either create a movie directly. I can either use AVI, FFmpeg to create an AVI movie, Ogthiora, which is an open source format, that's also a movie format. Or what I can do is I can create all the images. So basically, you know, if I have 43 timeframes that make up this movie, I can save out 43 different images. And and then what I can do is afterwards, I can kind of compose them together into a movie using a different tool like FFmpeg. I'm going to go with the default here and just have it write the movie. And then we can, similar to the other one, we can choose a bunch of things like, you know, how big it's going to be and the frame rate. So I think what I want, there's 43 frames. Let's go 15 frames a second. We don't want to be waiting, maybe 25 frames a second. We don't want to be waiting like forever. So we're saving out the animation. Cool. Now, if I go to the Finder here, and I look at the disk animation, and I try with the VLC. There we go. Let me then show you something else that we can do is we can change the camera angle of this. So let's go, we can actually have the camera follow along. And I go back to the first frame here. And what I'm going to do here is in this animation view, I'm going to add a camera that can orbit. I will just choose the defaults. And now what will happen is that when I play, the camera is actually going to zoom around. Okay. If I got rid of that, you'll notice that the camera stays kind of focused from the same position, right? So if I add a camera orbit, I added a camera orbit. Let me try that again. We will see that the camera orbits around. Now we can actually go and edit that orbit. So I double click on camera. There's kind of two keyframes of which starting at time zero, there's going to be a path. If I double click that, I now get three parts of the path. There's the camera position and the camera focus. If I click on position, I actually get this view. So the orbit the camera takes is actually this yellow line. Now it has a focal position, which is going to be the center of the object. That's kind of specified by these menu items here, that there's the zoom to data. But what I can do is I can, you know, put the camera up really high over here. Okay, it's a bit wonky, but it's more just to give you the idea of the path that the camera will take. Let me just kind of make this take a stranger path. After I've modified that, I go back to the dialogue, click OK, OK again. And now when I go to orbit, it's going to be quite crazy, right? But you can set the orbit, and it doesn't have to be an orbit, that orbit's closed, but you can set a path that just has, you know, a different start and end position, just so that maybe you keep the camera focused on the interesting parts of your data set over time. Or even, for example, let me just show you here what we can do with this very nice example visualization, which is that that hot disk. Okay, so this one, there's no time here. So, but what happens if you wanted to kind of get a view around the entire structure? So let me just go and make this, and I make the clip so that it's, I'm gonna make it so that it's transparent. Okay, what I'd like to be able to do is basically see this from different points of view. Basically, you know, in the same way that I, you know, might manipulate this object on screen, which is really just updating my camera, I can do this from the animation view. So again, the animation view is at the bottom. And what I'd like to do is add a camera. Okay, so the first thing I want to do is I want to specify, so right now it has start time of 0, end time of 1, and the number of frames is 10. so this will basically go around the object in 10 steps. Let me just make it 50 or 60. And I'm going to add a camera orbit to it, and I keep the default values. And now when I run, it's going to automatically orbit, even though that this data set didn't have a time frame. You know, there was, so basically from the animation view, I can add my own. And now if I go and I'll go and save my animation, and I'll call this disk. I think I already saved two. Cool. And now I'm going to go up. Okay. And so now basically I'm watching the movie in VLC, and I could also speed it up a little bit too. I could loop it, speed it up. So, or I could slow it down if I really wanted to watch some process that was unfolding very quickly. I could slow it down or go much faster. So, you know, so by saving the animation, it gives me options to kind of explore the data outside of ParaView. And it gives there are people opportunity to explore part of the data set too. Not in the same level of detail that having the data set would give you, but you know, a sense. And there's other output options as well that allow you to choose things like which variable you're viewing information for, things like that, that are a little more general. But this is the two basic sorts of outputs very commonly used. So here we've seen basically how we choose the camera orbit, we set the number of frames, we can see what's going to happen when we press the play button, and we can adjust the camera's orbit, which you saw us do. So if you've chosen to save out as a bunch of image files, there's ways that you can use other tools to kind of combine them all together into a movie. And this is an example of how you might use FFmpeg from the command line to take all the PNGs numbered in a certain way, and ParaView will number them when it generates them and create an MPEG file as output. So MPEG wasn't available from ParaView directly, but we could have made it ourselves just going from the image files. One of the nice things about using image files as well is that if you get a glitch, like, you know, some sort of processing glitch, you know, 100 frames into the movie, what you could do is you just get rid of that image, or you could try to extract just that image again. So this gives you some flexibility. Also, if you have very large data sets, and you could basically run, if you want to create a movie with 100 frames, you could actually just run 100 jobs where each job just grabs one image, one kind of screenshot, and then you'd stitch them together later on. So that's kind of some of the things that you can do. So basically, that's my little demo of using ParaView to basically create the scientific visualization pipelines that Thomas was talking about. With that, we have, you know, a half hour left to answer your questions. You know, thank you for staying, and basically, you know, we're here to help. Everything from this, just the basics and getting figuring out how to do stuff in ParaView. You know, we know it's complex and challenging, and sometimes it needs figuring strange issues out. So, so we're here to help. And so also just to keep in mind that if you're interested in, if you have larger data sets that you typically work with on the supercomputer or an IBEX, or you want to become a programming power user of ParaView and work and create your visualizations offline, like, you know, so that when you're not there, you can kind of process large amounts of data. Our next series of workshops will help you with that. So thank you very much. I'll turn it back over to Thomas, and we're ready to answer whatever questions you have. Thanks.
Thanks, Kendon. Thanks a lot. I wanted to quickly answer the one question that I did post a link in the chat to the question of Bargav. I hope I pronounced the name correctly. So the problem there is essentially you have a grid, and your data on the grid changes, and actually in ParaView and VTK, actually you have to save out the whole grid with every time step. That's how it's done. So I have done a quick Google search and found this static mesh plugin by Kitware itself. I have not used it myself. I would ask you to look at it and let me know first if you have any problem. I would like to look at it. I'll be busy next week, but afterwards I'll definitely can help you with that. If you solve the problem yourself, please let me know as well. I would just like to know. I hope that helps. Also, what I wanted to add is if you have a problem, just shoot us an email at help@biz.kaust, and we'll try to help you directly. We are actually a bit before time. Perfect. Have a good day. Have a good evening. Have a good weekend, and maybe see you in one of the next workshops.